education and the importance of education and the continuity of every member's, you know, quality of life, especially during the emergencies. My name is Ethan, and I work with the organization Education Above All, which is an umbrella that has four programs that are all focused in supporting education. Reach Out to Asia is an organization I've been serving for the last 8 years, but there are also other programs such as Educate a Child, Alpha, and Peace. But today here we're about to talk about the importance of education. To provide education and normalcy of life of a child during any turbulent time, you know, most of people overlook the importance of education in such a case, and it's always been seen as non-priority. While education indeed is a very important factor of guaranteeing the human dignity and an investment for everyone to put on. I highly applaud our brother here who talked about the importance of a family life. But a very important lesson I learned from our brother Kofi is the word integration that you have mentioned. And integration, and how do we link integration into such a very important time, and why integration and education? Let's talk about the opposite of integration, which is isolation. Isolation in such times, especially at the time that we live in, we're in a highly intellectual time where knowledge is defining you as a person, where knowledge defines you as a value, who you are and what can you do, and most importantly, what can you contribute to the community that you live in. And without knowledge, you're not identified, you're not integrated, and you are being neglected. And what can be more dismantling any human personality and dismantling human value is isolation. And this is why, if you're not educated, you're isolated, because you're not being seen as an added value to the community and as a true contributor to the growth of the community that you work with. And this is why, you know, our work as an organization that focuses on education really relies on four main pillars. The first pillar is access to education, you know, building the schools, rehabilitating the schools, providing the computer labs, the libraries, the labs, the psychosocial support rooms, and so many other things that, you know, access is a must. And there are lots of innovative educational resources that could be put into access. Very recently I was in Sudan, and I was really interested to see how education can be so innovative, and access to education can happen in so many ways. Education is no longer the classroom and the dashboard and the chalk and the book and the teacher. In Darfur and Cordoba, we've seen a very interesting model of the nomad communities. And these are not people under crisis or anything. It's their lifestyle, where they'll be traveling from place to place along with their cattle and their children with them. But a very interesting model is the nomad teacher. How can we get a teacher to travel with those families? And this teacher can be given, you know, for example, a cow or a cattle that can be given to him, apart from providing a salary. And this teacher will travel with them from place to place and continue teaching their children. Another innovative solution is, for example, in Bangladesh, where we've seen floating classrooms, you know, where Brad have provided very interesting classroom, you know, where, you know, a boat can be changed into a classroom. In Lebanon, Reach Out Asia have partnered with the American University of Beirut, where we have, because of the provision of land is a challenge in Lebanon, how about, you know, a dismantled classroom of a good quality that could be provided to provide quality education. So access is the first pillar, and access is possible. The second pillar is building the capacities of young people, you know, and especially youth and volunteerism. And how can a young person from the age 14 to 23 community, it takes a nation to educate a child. And education is not just about the school administration and the teacher and the community, you know. We're talking about ministries of education, we're talking about the school administration, we're talking about the teachers, we're talking about the community, we're talking about the NGO, and so many other players and key players who contribute to education. So education is a multifaceted, multi-stakeholder process that, once done correctly, can give us fruitful results. Another example I can give is, for example, the Interagency Network for Education and Emergency IME, which also Rota is a member of, and brings all the stakeholders in a very effective and dynamic way of finding solutions, putting toolkits, you know, reviewing results, putting surveys, collecting data, and how can we, as an international education community, look for solutions and actively participate in putting those, influencing governments and providing feedback and sharing knowledge and providing evidence-based solutions that will be looked into, you know, the educational process. The fourth pillar that we also look into is sustainability and local ownership. Because as we can witness today, ladies and gentlemen, the world is really experiencing and donor fatigue in every level of every crisis we're looking at. The refugees number have escalated to skyrocketed, you know, numbers that since World War II, the world had never witnessed such numbers. And the average refugee life in refuge is actually 17 years. So in an average situation, if a 7-year-old kid comes to your country, the average number of years you're looking at that he will be leaving you, if he will be at the age of 23. So it's your responsibility as a hosting community, or as a hosting country, to not look into that 7-year-old kid, but the 23-year-old young adult, and how do you want to shape that kid to be? Do you want him to be the illiterate person who's eventually going to end up as a burden for you, because he is going to be the one who's going to be rebuilt the country once he goes back to? Or do you want to build the active citizen, the educated person? 20 years old could be an engineer, 20 years old could be a teacher, 20 years old could be a doctor, you know? Or do you want him to be a person who's illiterate, who could be recruited in you know, any kind of movement? Or just an independent and unreliable person who will be looking for you to support? So this is why we're talking about education as not just a necessity for a person, you know, to be able to read and write. It's about providing them with this source of dignity and this reliable person. Because eventually, and looking into numbers, actually investing in education is a long-term return on investment for any donor country or even hosting country, for any refugees or any, you know, other source of disaster, whether it is natural disaster or man-made. Another thing that I want to talk about is the importance of research and the importance of providing evidence-based solution for us as an international education community. Unfortunately, in lots of cases, education is not being seen as that tangible need, you know, that we have to support. You know, an empty stomach is not as important as an empty brain, you know. However, you can see the poster of a hungry child or an ill child or someone who has no shelter or someone who's being recruited, you know. But an illiterate child is something, or even a teacher quality training, for example, you know. Any donor would say, I'll be happy to build a school. But once you start talking about teacher quality training on quality education, you know, for example, children with disabilities, it's not something that comes into their appetite. And this is why I want to talk about the importance of how can we, as an international education community, you know, showcase, you know, this kind of an importance, you know, bring a tangibility to that case that we're bringing, but most importantly, you know, be seen as none less than any other important things such as shelter, Luckily, you know, the international community is understanding and validating that, especially when we talk about the Sustainable Development Goals, you know, and the SDG 4, that comes as a continuation from the Millennium Development Goals. But as you can see, the world is recognizing that Millennium Development Goal is not enough. Let's add the word sustainability, because sustainability is a must. And with education, sustainability can definitely come, because an educated mother, an educated child, an educated father, an educated, you know, young person is way more reliable and would provide you with the sustainability that you look at. I wanted my session, I hope I won't talk very much, with a quote from one of my favorite movies, V for Vendetta, which, you know, says, you know, an idea is bulletproof, and once it's given, it can never be taken away. You know, and this is the epitome of sustainability and empowerment for any young children. So thank you very much, and we're looking forward to hearing from you.